Intel has rolled out their 12th and 13th generation processors recently, and unlike almost every other x86 processor on the market, these have two different types of cores. Intel calls them P-cores and E-cores. A P-core is a physically larger core with more cache, higher clock speed, and higher performance, and an E-core is a physically smaller core, less cache, lower clock speed, and lower performance. And Intel shows this as a way of having very high single-threaded performance, but still having very high multi-threaded performance because the E-cores have a higher performance density on the die compared to just having lots of P-cores like they used to do in the past. But this brings up a lot of issues when it comes to virtualization and other programs that have been used to dealing with all of the same type of cores for many years now. So today I'm going to take a look at how Proxmox deals with these different types of cores and just see how this whole thing works when it comes to virtualization and see what types of issues there are and see if I can potentially take advantage of these different types of cores to make the system work better or save power. Since Proxmox is based upon Debian Linux, I first wanted to test how well Debian would be able to deal with running a process of different amounts of threads and seeing what cores it would allocate it to. But first I had to figure out which cores were P-cores and which cores were E-cores. And luckily there's a nice little tool called lstopo that's built into the repositories. You can use apt install hwloc to install this package. And if you run it on a system without a GUI, you get this nice little output here. And what it shows you is it shows you your system, potentially different NUMA nodes if you have those, and then it shows you all the different logical processors and how much cache it has and what it shares. And in this example, you can see that the P cores each have two logical threads and it shows you which number those threads are. And then it shows you the E cores have some shared cache and it shows you which E cores are associated with each other. So on my setup right here, which I have a 12900K with, I have 8 P cores and 8 E cores. And on my system, logical processors from 0 to 15 are P-cores, and processors from 16 to 23 are E-cores. And then logical processors 0 through 1 are sharing one P-core. And then 2 and 3 also share one P-core and use hyperthreading, and so on. So what I first did was just allocate a simple process using stress to use one thread and see what it would be allocated to. And it allocates it to one P-core. Now it can potentially allocate it to a P-core that is able to clock at the highest speed if it is able to use Intel Turbo Boost Max 3, but in this case it doesn't really matter for a lot of CPUs that don't support that feature. And then if I allocate anywhere between 1 and 8 cores, it will use up all of my P-cores. When I allocate between 9 and 16 threads, it will use all of my P-cores and then start to use up all of my E-cores. And then once all my E-cores are used, so if I have between 17 and 24 different threads being allocated, it will start to use up the second logical thread of all of my P-cores on my system. I then did a little bit of performance testing using Cinebench to try to see how much this would make sense and to see if this would be a reasonable way to allocate the processes. And it turns out Linux kernel is correct. This is typically the best way to allocate the processes if your goal is to have the best performance. The P-cores are the fastest on their own. The E-cores are typically about 50% of the speed of the P-cores in this case on the system, and it turns out the second logical thread on the P-core once the main one is already fully used up is about 30% of the speed. So I can think of it as the main P-core is 100% of the speed, the E-core is 50% of the speed, and the second logical thread on the P-core is 30% of the speed once the first part of the P-core is already used up. Now that I did some testing with some artificial utilities like stress and Linux, I wanted to see how well this would apply to virtual machines. And luckily it applies super well, because virtual machines in Linux are treated like just another processor to the scheduler. So the processors will assign those virtual machines to whatever threads it sees fit. So typically, it'll assign those virtual machines to P-cores, E-cores, second half of P-cores. And when running multiple virtual machines, it worked pretty well. And since I wanted to test running multiple virtual machines just to see if something weird would happen when you load it up with a dozen virtual machines and maybe it has a higher load, I added the system to a main cluster with my primary system and moved over as many virtual machines as I could. And really, I didn't have any issues. The virtual machines just moved over and started running. They performed well, as would be expected. And pretty much looking at the system, only the P cores were being used. The E cores were almost never being touched, and the second half of the P-cores were basically never being touched. And taking a look at my system, I see typically a pretty low CPU usage. And this is in line with what I see with a lot of other home labs and small business setups. Typically with virtualization, you're using virtual machines to put a lot of different VMs that each have a relatively low load together. That way you can have one kind of bigger system instead of a lot of little ones. And typically it runs under quite low CPU load, and things like memory and disk I/O become a limitation well before CPU usage becomes a limitation. But unfortunately that means the E-cores essentially did nothing for me, and turning them off would have almost no effect. So I wanted to try to say, maybe we'll force those VMs onto the E-cores to see if that could help with power consumption or something like that. So I tried using the offline CPUs feature in Linux, where I can give a command to a CPU and it'll go offline, and essentially not exist to the kernel or scheduler. So I did that to all of the P-cores except 0, because I can't offline processor 0, and that moves all my processes over to the E-cores, and unfortunately, I still max out that single P-core. And power consumption wasn't really affected that much. If I was under heavier loads, it would go down because most of my processors couldn't be used anymore. But that would also mean that performance would be impacted because most of my performance is now disabled. Unfortunately for a lot of workloads, the P-cores aren't more power efficient than the E-cores. But unless you're under pretty light loads, the performance efficiency of the P-cores and E-cores per watt is relatively similar. So going to all E-cores really doesn't save you too much power, and just using less CPU usage would save you about the same amount of power. Now for some workloads where you have a constant amount of work, switching to P-cores would save you a reasonable amount of power consumption, but that's really just because the E-cores can do less work, so they use less power, and just turning down the clock speed would do a similar task. One thing to note is if your goal is to save power consumption with these systems, is by default their clock speed is typically quite high, which is very inefficient. Turning down their clock speed or TDP will save you a lot of power without losing that much performance. Unlike virtual machines where the scheduler will assign that virtual machine to whatever cores it sees fit, containers in Proxmox will be allocated a specific set of processes using CPU sets, and then it'll be stuck to those logical processors' cores. And unfortunately, that means you can sometimes get some pretty ugly allocation. So in one of my testing, I saw that one of my systems was allocated to a logical core as part of a P-core, it then had two logical processes as part of another P-core, and then the last five of its processors were all assigned to E-cores, which means it got some pretty suboptimal performance compared to being allocated to all P-cores, for example. And to my knowledge, in Proxmox, there's no easy fix to this. The cores get allocated as Proxmox sees fit, and it pretty much means you get some ugly allocations every once in a while, and you have to assume that your containers can potentially get some quite poor performance, and also that all your containers will not have the same level of performance on systems with P and E cores. This is kind of an issue if you have just hyperthreading, but with P and E cores, it gets a whole lot worse. One hacky solution I thought of to deal with this was to just run Proxmox in a virtual machine on top of Proxmox and run containers on that. And because the virtual machine that's running the containers is able to have its threads allocated by the main system, because how virtual machines can have their threads handed around as the kernel sees fit, that means the VM that's running containers can have its threads that are using the most, and likely the most important, assigned to the P cores and having the best performance. Kind of an ugly solution, and unfortunately the Proxmox developers will likely have to do something to deal with this in order to improve this situation, as there's no easy workaround from what I can see. Overall, I was surprised how well virtualization worked on this system. Pretty much, P-cores, E-cores, second half of P-cores worked as expected. This system performs very well. It has some pretty nice high performance cores, and overall you just fill up virtual machines and it works, and didn't have any crashes or issues. Containers, on the other hand, there's definitely some issues to work out when it comes to how cores are allocated for containers. I don't even know the best way in my head exactly how to allocate that. Maybe just let the kernel handle the CPU sets, but I'm not sure if that can easily be done under the hood or with tweaking. So there's definitely some work to be done to make sure containers work well on this platform. But I think if you only plan to do virtual machines or mostly plan to do virtual machines, I don't see a major issue with buying a system with P-cores and E-cores. And as they become more common, you're likely going to be stuck with having to buy one of these systems, especially as Intel's been able to be rolling out to a lot of their new systems now, especially in laptops and lower power platforms. And I believe AMD plans on doing a similar bigger cores and little cores too in future product lines. But at the current moment, if you're doing desktop processors, the Zen AMD systems seem to make a lot of sense, because you get a full 16 cores on something like a 7950X, so you don't have to deal with these P-cores and E-cores, don't have any of the container issues, and they're still pretty darn high performance cores. So I think if you're going for a home server, AM5 makes a lot of sense compared to this system, and it's one less issue to deal with. But if you want some of the features of this system, like perhaps its media decoding abilities with Quick Sync, or some of the other Intel features you could potentially want to use, going with an Intel 12900K or other 12th and 13th generation processors is a perfectly reasonable option for Proxmox, but just be aware about containers and make sure that that's okay with how you're going to use your system. Thanks for watching, and let me know if you've had any experience using P-cores and E-cores in virtualization and how that's worked out for you.